So there I was, starting all over again. My engagement had fallen apart, and my new job was full of new people, I was living on my own, and I was the master of my own fate all over again. Quickly, the sadness that I was carrying regarding my recent past was turned into an excitement about this new world where no one expected anything from me, and I was completely free to walk down any path that I deemed important or interesting. The new job was a great distraction, as it was fast-paced, full of energy, and I was around a brand new group of people that all wanted to have as much fun as I did in my mid-20s. There were parties, drinking, sex, friendships formed, enemies found, you know, life. The petty conflicts between co-workers melted away the next day, the sordid bar night romances ignored once sober, and all the perfect distraction from the depression I had been dealing with and the lack of direction I had been struggling with. The job itself was rather strenuous and exhausting, but the promises of moving up through the ranks was the light at the end of the tunnel that I had been looking for, and it was a perfect motivator for me to do my damnedest and make sure that I was noticed. Somewhere along the way in those first few months, a click went off in my head, and my usual negativity and anger at the world faded into a cautious optimism. My journal from that time period is full of motivational speeches to myself, explanations of my past actions to my current self, a sense of hope, a sense of faith that my life was going to turn out all right, and even though I don't mention God very often, I still believed that if I moved forward with life, God would guide my steps and I would eventually succeed in every area of my life. But as my story goes, over and over, I can see the cracks of the damage, and just as water flowing through the cracks of concrete will topple the greatest of monuments, the water flowing into my damaged cracks was a trickle of unresolved anger. My frustration with having to start playing the political games at work, and seeing other newer people being welcomed in a way that I never was, started to build up and bubble out from time to time. I think we've all seen that at some point in our lives. We struggle to be accepted by a group of people, and maybe we finally move into a sort of low-Earth orbit around that group. We're neither accepted nor rejected, but we're never really allowed to come to rest on the surface. Then that new person comes along, and for whatever reason, you don't like them. But somehow, they don't have to go through the initiation process that you did, and they're accepted fully from day one and considered one of the in-group. I've often wondered if I didn't like them before they ascended to a higher social position than me, or only after, but I've never been able to figure it out, and from time to time in my life, I've been the one that just breezes in and is accepted into the in-group. So maybe it's all just timing. I feel that the unresolved anger was late-blooming resentment to my parents for not preparing me for this world. And it was also anger at myself for not being more assertive in taking the reins of my own destiny. I preferred to blame others for my own shortcomings. My parents, the system, God, and while I still believe that my upbringing created a stunted human being that was about as ready for the world as a 14-year-old is, I can see that instead of doing the things I needed to do to get beyond that anger trap, I ignored my own faults and simply blamed others for them. I wrote a fair amount about the price and cost of imagination at this time, and the pattern for me has always been the following. Life falls apart, reality becomes more clear through the eyes of reevaluation, past decisions are weighed on the scales of beneficial versus detrimental, and using my imagination, I contemplate how my life would have been different if I had only turned left instead of right. But then I frustrate myself with those daydreams to the point where I make some grand speech about doing better in the present and setting lofty goals for the future. I set out with a renewed sense of wonder and hope and purpose, and finally, life happens for a while. Then rinse and repeat. While I don't really mean for the series to be all about the relationships that I've had in my life, my decisions, thus far, have revolved around my relationships with others, as is much of the case with most of the people that I've met. So by March of 2003, I had already become enamored with a coworker that was witty, intelligent, beautiful, and broken. By broken, I mean she was sad, depressed, lonely, and lacked any hope that her job, her marriage, her life, would give her the meaning she wanted and the happiness she wanted, deserved or not. I kept my distance due to her married status, but we became good friends and we started to talk about aspects of life that I never talked about before. Her religious upbringing was even harsher than mine, and she still bore the emotional and psychological scars of both mental and sexual abuse at the hands of her family's pastor. So we had a fair amount to talk about regarding religion, spirituality, and God. Yeah, that last sentence is a perfect example of why I hate religion. And before anyone says, well, that's a one-off, yeah, bullshit. Total bullshit. It was during this time that I started my journey into some aspect of Eastern religions, and after reading Alan Watts and Robert Persig and Gary Zukav and all sorts of other authors and ideas, I started to identify myself with some of the Zen beliefs and adopted some practices such as meditation and embracing all life as an extension of self. It was all new agey and spiritual without feeling like I had turned my back on my core religious beliefs, but it was an opening of my mind to accept that maybe God wasn't as small as Christianity made him out to be, and maybe even the concept that God was a he came under fire, and I resorted to stating both gender-specific terms when talking about God. For example, I wrote an entire short story about the end of the world that had one sentence referring to God's actions using him, followed by another sentence using her. It really made the story all kludgy and repetitive, but I felt a strong need to give equal representation at the time. And while I never fully embraced Buddhism in any way, the understanding that our actions affect all of the world around us was a worthy lesson I still believe. And I still try to remember that every time I leave the water running for no reason, or if I hold the door open for someone just to be nice. While it's not necessarily a Buddhist concept, the idea of paying it forward has become a philosophical truism in my life, although I'm not perfect and sometimes I do fail. Soon after this friendship formed, I quit my job in a preemptive move to keep myself from being fired. I had lost my cool a few too many times while at work, and the conflicts from months prior with coworkers had created yet another us-versus-them situation where my team was on the losing side, and I was the sacrificial lamb. Months later, I'd find out that the way everything was handled by management was improper, and that I shouldn't have quit and should have taken the issue above the heads of those in power over me, but that was months later, so it didn't matter anymore. And so in a move that still shocks me to this day, being unemployed didn't actually scare me into getting another job very quickly. I sold belongings to make rent and pay bills and pay for dog food, and when I was out of random things that I was willing to sell, I hit up my parents for help, and for whatever reason, they did, and I was able to stay unemployed for about 5 months during the summer of 2003. I spent a lot of that time reading, writing, and continuing to grow closer to this girl that we'll call Laura. Her marriage had been crumbling long before I came around, but the sense of hope and optimism, when I could actually muster some, gave her some hope that life isn't supposed to be simply acceptable or mundane. Seeing her marriage crumble and believing that she was her own person, capable of making her own decisions, I held my tongue when she complained or talked about it, but not so secretly I imagined her leaving her husband and joining me on an adventure-filled life. I even put together a shitty website to try and get family and friends to give a small donation that I was going to use to buy an RV, drive over to Laura's house, honk the horn, wait for her to jump in, and then travel the country working odd jobs and living free of the constraints of a 9-to-5 job and other social norms. In the end, that plan never got beyond the planning stages, but it was that sense of adventure and high times in the face of what I had always been told I should generally be paying attention to, like a career, marriage, school, kids, security, that marked that time in my life. It wasn't so much rebellion as it was trying to reform my opinions of the world and my stances in regards to questions of value, morality, purposes, and identity. I've always believed that the past does create the person that you are, but I have also always known that the present determines the person that you will be. The idea of being here, now, in the present, aware of what you're doing, who you are, what you can do to not only change your own life but the lives of those around you, positively or negatively, and the simple fact that your life is your own to do with what you deem fit, is something that even now as an atheist I consider one of the most profound lessons I've ever learned, regardless of where it came from. I've never stayed in counseling long enough to get any kind of diagnosis from a trained psychologist, but my armchair psychology knowledge sees all sorts of red flags when I look at my life and my writings from that summer. I begin to talk about myself as two different people. There's the person that I am and the person that I pretend to be. I praise the compassion, talent, and endless love of who I am, while chastising the selfish, hateful, undermining person I externalize, but I never see a compromise, and I never try and pull both of those sides into one solid, healthy person that can show emotion without fearing the extremes of self-sacrifice or unadulterated hate becoming the end result. It's a common theme for years to come, and I started to shut down yet again. Laura's marriage eventually ended, and she and I pursued a relationship beyond late-night ponderings and endless conversations. Sex and curling up on the couch replaced our deep talks, and questions about how we should be moving forward together filled the times we couldn't be intimate. The flirting and pursuing were gone as we both got what we wanted, but we didn't know how to keep things as intellectually stimulating as before. Our talks about God and religion got replaced with talk about her job and my lack of motivation to find a job, and even in the blossoming moments of our unfettered relationship, I could feel the conflict of the two me's I mentioned before fighting for dominance. On one hand, I had a beautiful, intelligent, and awesome woman before me that wanted me as much as I wanted her, but on the other hand, I wasn't really sure if I was the loving and compassionate person I claimed to be, or the cold and calculating person I saw staring back at me from my reflection. I was filled with hope for a positive future, but my lack of motivation to get moving with life and get my shit together was pulling me into apathy and the blame game all over again. Before she could see the struggle inside me beyond what she already knew about me, I was forced to head back to Ohio for just a few months at the end of 2003 to work for a friend. While away from Laura, she stayed in my apartment with my dog, and I made a couple of road trips back to see her when I could. Whenever I was back, she and I enjoyed each other's company, talked for hours about life and new books or new ideas, and generally had a good time. I missed her while I was in Ohio, and she missed me, and I thought that I could use the time away from her to figure out who the hell I was and how to move forward into a healthy life and a healthy relationship. We talked a lot on the phone about honesty and openness, and we felt that the conventional roles of boyfriend-girlfriend were archaic and flawed, and that we needed to try to employ straightforward, almost brutal honesty in our relationship to be sure that we weren't lying or being dishonest with each other or ourselves. It was a noble goal, and it allowed us to not play the game so many other relationships are plagued with. Do these pants make my ass look big? Do you mind if I play video games all night? Was it as good for you as it was for me? We felt that all those little white lies we tell each other were detrimental to a healthy relationship because it fostered distrust when truly important matters were discussed. So we tried not to do it at all, and we did a decent job of it for a fair amount of time. If I pissed her off, she didn't shut down, and we talked. If she pissed me off, I tried not to shut down, and I would fight against my past habit and actually open up and talk about it. It did lead to some awkward conversations, but I've been a more honest and forthright person since then, so it was worth the discomfort. So after a few months working in Ohio and Indiana, I had enough money for our next big plan. The RV idea may have never took off, but the call of the open road and new places remarkably different than Ohio or Oklahoma still called to both of us. So late in December of 2003, I sold my car, bought a minivan, grabbed my travel clothes, drove back to Oklahoma, picked up both Laura's and my belongings in my van and her car, and then on New Year's Day 2004, we headed out for our next big adventure together. Final stop, Seattle. What do I believe about man's relationship to the rest of the cosmos? How do we fit in? What is the cosmos' relationship to humanity? How does it fit in? What's the purpose of having a gigantic, inconceivable universe if we're only going to inhabit one planet and one solar system and one galaxy and one corner of an expanse so large? Why? I don't know. Will we ever know? I don't know. I don't know what else is out there, nor do I really care that much. Is our space program a waste of time? Yes. Are we ever going to travel the expanse known as the universe? Not all of it. Why exactly are we here? I think that God actually had a whole lot of time on his hands. I mean, he's been around forever. How could he not have time? And we're all just an experiment that will end when this world ends. When? I don't know. All we can do is dig around for answers to unasked questions and hope that someday someone will come up with questions we need to fit together the answers we already have. Very few of my answers to the questions posed to my 17-year-old self by my Bible teacher ring of so much ignorance and apathy as that one. I don't care. Who was that idiot kid? Now, to be fair, it was question 5 of 9, and it was a school assignment, but some of the deepest questions ever asked should have been given a little bit more attention and exploration. I can tell I was already on my downward spiral of apathy regarding school at this point, and really, how much easier can it be than to answer an essay question with, "Don't care." Regardless, the bits of my answer that actually relate to the question display a brain infused with creationist gunk and presents a prime example of a wondrous mind being shrunk by dogma and forced religious indoctrination. I remember being a kid and free to run and play and not actually have to worry about things. I remember going out to my grandma and grandpa's and exploring the woods and nature and waiting for dusk to come so we could run around and catch lightning bugs before falling to the ground, rolling over on our backs, and gazing up at the stars as they twinkled into view. Eventually, that gave way to the immensity of the Milky Way, visible only as a cloud of slightly lighter space. I remember my intense love for the planet Saturn, replaced later by a near obsession with Mars, that still continues, albeit slightly abated. So what happened to that child that stared at the stars and the moon with such wonder and awe? What caused him to turn away from the wondrous? Well, disappointment. I believed that a God that made such an awesome universe should have given us a way to move around it, should have plunked us down in a more crowded area of the galaxy, set up wormholes to warp us from one region to another, and seeded the other planets with life and habitable environments. I'm reminded of a meme I've seen many times on the internet that says, "I've always imagined God as the being that could have created real-life Pokemon, but instead, nah, malaria." God was getting smaller and smaller and less powerful, and my wonder and awe with the universe I was a part of began to shrink right alongside him. And of course, at that point, I was already done asking the pointed questions I had learned so many years prior led only to ridicule and scoffing from the teachers. I was going through the motions necessary to graduate, not trying to learn more about those things I would struggle with for years and years, such as direction, purpose, and meaning. While shedding my religious and theistic views has caused me to reevaluate everything all over again, I finally learned and started living my life as it should be, with me in control as much as the causality of the universe and the free will of my mind will allow me to be. My relationship to the cosmos, as has been so eloquently put by others before me, is that I am made of star stuff, and that we are all connected to each other biologically, to the Earth chemically, and to the rest of the universe atomically. To reduce the value and pure awe of being the conscious universe by stating time and again that you are flawed, imperfect, sinful, and damned? Well, it's no wonder so many of us have spent so long stumbling around in the dark. We closed our eyes to the wonder and clamped our hands over our mouths to stifle the questions and plugged our ears to reality, all in the name of genuflecting to an evil and vindictive phantasm that claims love is attainable only through blind belief, ignorance in the face of reality, and the forced removal of our own humanity and value. When I go out on the porch some nights, I look up at the stars and the moon. I always feel insignificant in the face of such expansiveness, but as I gaze at the craters on the moon, see the red tent of Mars and watch Orion watching over me, I never feel worthless, and I never feel damned. If they could talk to me, I think that they would only encourage, never judge me. They would be envious in the same way I was envious of the birds for their ability to fly, the fish for their ability to breathe underwater, and the stars for shining so brightly as to light up entire worlds. I found that my place in this world is determined solely on who and what I want to affect. While only 1 out of 7 billion, I want my life to mean something to more than just me. I want to do what I can while I'm here to promote a philosophy of understanding and rational thought. I want to explore the frontier of the human mind and cross the oceans of religion so that future generations can have a chance to never lose the wonder and excitement I had as a child. I don't want to see one more person pulled down from the high of feeling one with the universe so that they can be made to feel inadequate or threatened with eternal torture unless they can train their minds to accept something when no other subject requires such blind obedience. The religious and the pious may admit from time to time that they are not perfect, but for the most part they think that by simply believing something, they are better than others, because they stopped thinking when the questions they had were deflected and dodged. They believe that that granted them a special place not only in heaven, but on this earth as well. They'll say, "Judge not, lest ye be judged." Well, fuck that if it means standing by quietly while children are beaten to death in the name of Proverbs 13:24. Fuck that if it means standing by quietly while 61% of my fellow countrymen don't believe that evolution by natural selection is true because Genesis says otherwise. Fuck that if it means standing by quietly while honor killings continue to occur in this world. Fuck that if it means standing by quietly while the rights of every LGBTQIA human has to fight for the rights granted to all others based on Leverite law that has no place in the government of the United States. And fuck that if it means standing by quietly while one more child dies a slow, painful, agonizing death from a completely treatable condition because their parents believe more in their imaginary friend and his magic beans than modern medicine. Burning children as witches, raping children, restricting freedoms and rights to human beings different than you, popping out as many babies as you can to build up an army for the glory of God? Is this truly what you want? Is this truly what you consider good and righteous and pure? I am so sorry for you. I'm so sorry for those that feel that their religion is more important than taking care of their planet and their children and their families, their friends, their communities, their own minds, and their own sense of wonder. I'm sorry that you have allowed your religion to shrink you down to even less than insignificant. If you're watching this and you're a believer and you're trying to justify everything that I've mentioned, I understand. I was there once. And whether you take this as an insult or not, I got better, and so can you. All you need to do is open your eyes again, wonder again, ask the questions again, seek the truth and not faith. For billions of years, atoms have been created, blown about, rested, picked back up, moved some more, and eventually they coalesced into you. It took me a really long time to understand the vastness of that, but we are a way for the cosmos to know itself. Imagine the complexity of that, and in the moment of comprehension, your God will shrink to the size of a mustard seed, and it can be cast away just as easily.
Brother survivors.